This is an update in my continuing coverage of Trappist 1, a system that has at least 7 Earth-sized planets in orbit around it, all thought to be rocky and potential abodes for liquid water. It's also an update for Proxima b by proxy, which has one world that might have liquid water. For more backstory on either of these systems, see my other updates on this channel. Two new studies have come out that paint a rather grim picture of red dwarf systems as far as the development of life is concerned, at least as far as life developing the way we think it happened here on Earth. The problem comes from an emerging, better overall understanding of just how much radiation is present in the habitability zones of these stars. Three worlds lie within TRAPPIST-1's habitability zone. The problem is that red dwarfs are small, cool stars, so that zone is very close in, much more so than with our own zone around our much brighter yellow dwarf. In the first study by Menasvi, Lingam and Loeb of Harvard, they detailed that the environment would be so radioactive that any atmospheres that these planets might have had were long ago destroyed. This is also a serious problem for Proxima b, which also orbits similarly closely to its star. But it gets worse. The other study done by Cecilia, Garraffo and colleagues, links to all papers mentioned in the description below, looked at the solar wind of TRAPPIST-1 and found that it would be orders of magnitude more powerful than what we see here on Earth. If that wasn't bad enough, the magnetic field of the star itself might directly connect with at least some of the planets, stripping them of any protection and possibly their atmospheres entirely. The question of red dwarfs being able to support life within their habitability zones has been the subject of quite a few papers since the discovery of TRAPPIST-1 and Proxima b. Seemingly each week a new one comes out. These studies have solidly disfavored life, at least as far as what we understand right now, but it's a fluid story and things could change, but as we see it right now, the chances of life in either system seems increasingly grim. But it's also worth noting that habitability zones can be extended. Many bodies in our solar system, most notably Europa, seem to have liquid water oceans underneath shells of ice. This kind of ice-water world seems to be a pretty common affair if our solar system is any indicator. Perhaps these sorts of worlds are the more likely place to find life in red dwarf systems, but these are also a lot harder to study from a distance, as if studying exoplanets for life wasn't already difficult enough. But it's only a matter of time before we find better candidates for water worlds like Earth orbiting more sun-like stars. There are other Earths out there, the odds overwhelmingly favor it, and three planets in our own system have at various times in the past hosted surface liquid water, and all three had it for a long enough period of time to allow for the development of simple life, though only Earth did as far as we know right now. Add that with the icy moons with subsurface oceans, and our solar system presents to us a rather glaring indicator that liquid water is probably not particularly scarce in the universe, and where there is water, there could be life. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently eyeing my bottle of water suspiciously. It's a breeding ground for aliens, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.